sung this one. When with the Savior we enter the glory land, won't it be wonderful there? Ended the troubles and cares of this story land, won't it be wonderful there? Won't it be wonderful there? Having no burdens to bear, joyously singing with heart bells all ringing, won't it be wonderful there? Walking and talking with Christ the Supernal, won't it be wonderful there? Praising, adoring the matchless eternal one, won't it be wonderful there? Oh, yes.
a brand. They're Resonator guitars. Everybody calls them Dobro because that's the main brand of them. But this is a cheap one, but it's a everybody
it's
calls
still
them.
It's a cheap one. It's still a Dobro.
Yeah, he was good. I'm learning. Yeah, that guy's good.
Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. Heir of salvation, purchase of
I want to be. I just praise him tonight.
There's a lighthouse on a hillside, and it overlooks life's sea. When I'm tossed, it sends down a light. It's a light that I might see, and the light that shines in darkness now will safely lead me home. If it wasn't for the lighthouse, I know this ship would sail no more. Everybody that lives around us, see, just tear that old lighthouse down. For the big ships don't sail by this way anymore. There's just no use in it standing round. Then my mind goes back to that stormy night, just in time I saw the light, and the light from that old lighthouse, it still shines down from the hill. And I thank God for the lighthouse. I owe my life to Him. For Jesus is the lighthouse, and from the rocks of sin, He has shone His light around me, that I might clearly see. If it wasn't for tell me, where would this ship be? Everybody that lives around us, say, just tear that old lighthouse down. The big ships don't sail by this way anymore. There's just no use in it standing round. But my mind goes back to that stormy night, when just in time I saw the light, and the light from that old lighthouse, yes, it still shines down from the hill. I thank God for the lighthouse. I owe my life to Him. Jesus is the lighthouse, and from the rocks of sin, He has shone His light around me, that I might clearly see. If it wasn't for the lighthouse, tell me, where would this ship be? If it wasn't for the lighthouse, tell me, where would this ship be?
Praise the Lord. All right. Let's go. Go to the book of Proverbs. Book of Proverbs. Proverbs chapter 2. Read three scriptures here. Proverbs chapter 2. Proverbs 2, verse 1. It says, "My son, if thou will receive my words and hide my commandments with thee, so that thou shalt incline thy ear unto wisdom and apply thine heart unto understanding. Yea, if thou criest after knowledge, and lift up thy voice for understanding. For thou seekest her as silver, and searchest for her as for hid treasure. Then shalt thou understand the fear of the Lord, and find the knowledge of God. For the Lord giveth wisdom. Out of his mouth cometh knowledge and understanding. And he lay up sound wisdom for the righteous. He is a buckler to them that walk uprightly." Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, for another opportunity to come together. We thank you for this meeting, and thank you for your presence, Lord. We feel your presence strong tonight. And Father, we need wisdom. We need words from you. We need understanding. We know that all wisdom does come from you. We can receive knowledge, and that is good for learning, but when it comes to wisdom, Father, we depend directly on you through your precious Holy Spirit that dwells within us. Lord, give us what we have need of today, tonight, and forever, and we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. I'm going to put this down here, and then I'm going to come down, and I'm going to talk just a little bit down here tonight, and because I believe this is family night, don't you? This is family night, and that's how we're going to talk, all right? As everybody knows, and everybody has, if you've been tuned in and been listening, there's just a whole lot going on. There's a whole lot going on in this Commonwealth, in our state. There's a lot going on in the United States, and there's a lot going on in the world. Not a lot of information that's out there about what's going on. I'm going to specifically talk just a little bit about this virus that's going on. It's called the coronavirus, but it's also specifically more detailed is the COVID-19 is what it's called. I spent just about all day today, gathering information and listening to as much news information that I could get. I went to the CDC website. I've listened to podcasts. I've tried to look for the experts on what they would know about what's going on. And there's a lot of talk going on out there, but there's very little information that's going on out there. But there's a reason for that. It's because they just don't know. They just don't know. And that's why we need wisdom and knowledge and understanding from the Lord about what we read in Proverbs. And the wisdom comes from Him. Because the information that I've gathered and received is that this virus, the coronavirus, has been around for a long time. This is not something new. What is new is the direction it's taken. It is, I guess the word is, mutated off into a branch of its own. And by it doing that and becoming not only surface but airborne, it is very, very, very contagious. And they haven't got a vaccine, they haven't got a cure, they haven't got anything developed at this point. They're working on it, yes, but they're saying, depending on who the information is, it could be 9 months to a year before that takes place, okay? Now, here's what I've had to do to decipher a lot of this. And believe me, I'm not the smartest person at all. And if somebody's got a little more insight on this, and this comes from praying too. This comes from trying to get discerning from the Spirit of God along with this information that comes in. And that's why we asked the Lord just a few minutes ago for wisdom to rightly be able to apply what we know and what we understand. I want to make sure that we're as informed as we can be, especially with what's going on. Everybody needs to know this, because this information is for you and your family, for me and my family, on how to best be prepared and to continue preparing for the future. Because, folks, this isn't just going away. Now, a lot of people will say to me, and if you don't say it, a lot of people will think this to me, you know, Brother Joe, where's your faith? Let me tell you, I've got faith, okay? But also, I'm a realist. I live in a real world too. I've got a spiritual world that I'm in, but also I'm in a real world. And in the real world, things happen, okay? Just because we're a child of God and because we have a spiritual covering, that spiritual covering does not keep us immune from sicknesses and diseases, okay? It does not do that. Can God protect us? Absolutely. And that's what we need to be praying. We need to be pleading the blood of Jesus, and we need to be praying over us and our families and saying, Lord, you keep any of the plagues of Egypt away from our houses, away from our homes, away from our family, and away from us. We pray that. That's our prayer. But also, God has given us something called common sense. He's given us the ability to learn, to receive knowledge, and be able to rightly apply that knowledge. When it's directed from Him, that becomes wisdom on how to deal with things. As I say it again, I do have faith, but I understand there's something real that's going on, and we better address it. We better not back away from it. We better get as much information as we can. That way you can make the best informed decision of what you need to do. Most of y'all probably heard the news and what the governor recommended. Now, let me tell you something. I haven't been a supporter, and I'm not as far on the political side of our governor. We're in difference, and we're in odds with values. My values and his is totally different. Just because he says something don't mean I'm going to run out and do something, okay? I don't work that way, and I'm not going to work that way. But I'm going to work with what information that not only the governor but also our emergency management and everybody that is getting directly from the CDC and Vice President Mike Pence, because he has been put over in charge of the area of this coronavirus and this. Now they're finally saying it. I've been asking the question, maybe not to a lot of people, but to myself, why haven't they declared this a worldwide pandemic? Well, you know what? Today, this morning, they finally said it's a worldwide pandemic. I said, why didn't they say that 2 weeks ago? Because it was spreading that fast. So finally they did, and they've declared it. We're under a state of emergency in the Commonwealth of Kentucky. It's been declared that. Why has it been declared that? It's because it opens our Commonwealth up for the necessary supplies and assistance that's needed from our federal government. We see what a lot of people don't understand about the federal government. The federal government just can't come into a state and start doing things and taking over. It don't work that way. There's a statute out there, and the term that most people in school learned several years ago, but you know today they're not teaching this in the schools. They don't teach civics and government and things like that we taught. But there's a term called posse comitatus. And what that means is that the states are sovereign and the federal government can't intercede under very strict emergency conditions. And then it's only limited. So the power rests in the governor of that state or commonwealth. Okay? So we are under a state of emergency, and therefore we need to make sure that we understand what that is. And I just told you, it just opens up for us to receive that from the government and get assistance as we need it. There's a lot of misinformation out there. There's a lot of things that's being said. One group or one agency will say this, and another will say that. For an example, this one over here will say, a government agency will say, now, we don't need to panic. Everybody needs to remain calm. We need to do the regular hygiene, wash your hands, use disinfectant, wipe down everything. And that's true. We need to do that. This group over here is saying what we need to do, we need to limit limit our social gathering. The term is called social distance. They're saying you need to keep a certain distance away. You need to, be at least 6 feet apart. Then you need to continue with the normal disinfecting and hygiene over here, okay? Then there's another group right here that's telling you that, you know what, this is really bad. You know, there's people dying. There's people going to continue to die. And all this stuff is a lot more serious than what a lot of people are talking about. So you see, somewhere in between is where you got to decipher everything that's going on. Okay? There's a lot of information out there, and we've got to gather this information. It's my responsibility as one of the leaders of this church to make sure that we become and stay informed as much as we can. And that's why I'm doing what I'm doing tonight. Because we in the coming weeks or the coming months, we're going to have to make some decisions. We're going to have to talk about it, and we're going to have to make some decisions. And I want everybody as informed, like I said. Let me touch on the economy just for a minute. We're very strong economically in this country, very strong. We have been for many, many years. The terrorists in 9/11 thought that they could take out our country by destroying the Twin Towers, because in those towers were the businesses basically of the world. That's why they call them the World Trade Centers. They were main offices and headquarters for a lot of businesses. And the terrorists thought if we could take these towers down, we could crush the economy of the United States. Well, everything slowed down, but guess what? Our economy was so strong, it puzzled. Well, we know it's the Lord. We know the Lord has blessed our country, but they were puzzled why our economy didn't collapse after 9/11. Our economy is strong today. Stock markets dropped drastically. You know, this week it's dropped drastically. There's a lot of people with 401ks that's scratching their heads saying, what, if it stayed like this, what am I going to do, okay? Because their retirements and everything are tied up in 401ks. But understand something, folks. That thing goes up and down all the time. And I think it's going to go back up. But we're going to have to weather a storm. We are going to have to weather a storm. And what's happening with us, because we've got such a strong economy, there's a ripple effect. That's what it's called. When something happens today, like this week, we may not feel this for 4 to 6 months down the road. But believe me, we will feel this, because it was too sharp of a drop. Italy has shut their country down, basically. Italy says, nobody in, nobody out. Basically, we're quarantining as many people. I can't see him back there, but it wasn't that 200 people died in 24 hours in Italy. There was a podcast that Jared and I was listening to, and there was a cardiologist that was quoted on there that was saying that it is hit so hard in certain area over there that they have quit testing the emergency workers, the people that are treating the sick, and they've basically said they're going to have to make a decision who lives and who dies. They're using the words all hands on deck. Everybody, all emergency personnel's got to be there working and taking care of what's going on. Over there, that's what's going on in Italy. These are the numbers I've heard. Now, I'm throwing all this out there, but I'm telling you, it's just for your information to know, okay? I'm giving you some information that you can pray, you can and should be praying about, we should be praying about, but I'm going to bring it back to our country now, where we are in the United States. And I think as of today, I believe there was 31 deaths so far in the United States. I listened to one of the doctors that is working with the CDC, he was actually on Fox News today, and he made this comment, he made this statement. He said, if things continue going the way it's going in the United States, he didn't say just in the world, he said in the United States, he said there could be millions die. This came from a doctor that is familiar with viruses. He said, now, the numbers I've heard range from 480,000 to millions. That's the gap we're in. And that is if nothing continues to be done. What they're saying is something has to be done. If something don't get done, they know what's going to take place. Now, is there things being done? Absolutely. What I'm saying is now the government is reaching out to the citizens and the people and saying, now you all too have a part to play in this. And our part to play in this is to limit our gatherings, especially large gatherings. Did you see where the NCAA now is going to play basketball with no fans in the gym? I mean, that's how serious they're taking this. Folks, it's not about money when it comes to public health, because schools are going to lose millions of dollars by fans not being sitting in the seats, okay? NCAA can probably, and some schools can take a pretty decent hit like that because they're getting some other monies over here. But there's something that's going on right now. It's called the Sweet 16 in the state of Kentucky. It was the state tournaments. And, yes, they're still going on. But you think about some of the schools, some of the teachers, if some of that money was cut off that they depend on. So is it connected to the economy, especially in our Commonwealth? Absolutely it is. But you're going to see this more and more. They've canceled parades. Large list of school, colleges and universities have shut down. They said, we're going on spring break, and when spring break's over, don't come back. We're cutting the semester short by 2 months. And University of Kentucky saying, we're going to continue online. Don't come back to campus. We're going to continue. So there's people that are taking this serious, and they should be taking this serious, what's going on. Because, and I'm not telling you the sky's falling, okay? I'm not an alarmist that's going out here and telling you all doom and gloom and the sky's falling. I'm telling you, if measures are not taken, then those numbers I just told you, they're going to come about, okay? Let's talk about age groups right now, okay? Youth, young, school, they're found out right now that it's not really affecting the majority. It didn't say that it wasn't affecting them at all. It says the majority right now. Evidently, the stronger your immune system is, the better you're going to fight this if it's contracted. Even people, young adults, teens, 20s, 30s, and 40s. If your immune system's strong, you're going to be able to fight this. And to some people, it's going to be like a common cold. If you've got a strong immune system, it'll be like a common cold. You might experience three to five days not feeling well, runny nose, a cough. About the sixth day, you'll get up and say, boy, I feel a lot better. You know, I think I'm ready to go back. And some of them will be able to do that. And there'll be some with weaker immune system but don't have any underlying medical conditions that they'll be down for 2 weeks and won't get out of bed. You know how the flu affects people differently. Even healthy people, it affects people differently. But this new virus is doing the same thing. Some people have contracted it, and some's been released from the hospital. Some, as soon as they feel the symptoms, they call in. They say, "I've got these symptoms." The main symptom is shortness of breath, other than the flu symptom. The normal flu symptoms is temperature. You got a temperature. You got a cough, and a lot of times with the flu, it's wheezing and coughing, but the other part of that is shortness of breath. And there have been some that go straight from being calling in and describing the symptoms, going to the hospital, and going straight to ICU. And some have just been quarantined for a period of 14 days, got through it, and been released. So nobody really can explain that, okay? This virus is new. This one is. Corona's been around for a while, but this one here has branched off and it's doing its own thing. And honestly, if you get right down to it, they don't know what to do, because we've never experienced this before. we're in ground that we've not experienced before. Major life disruptions is coming, even more so. Honestly, I just gonna have to speak it like it is. We're a spoiled bunch. Americans are a spoiled bunch. If we get disrupted in any way, we stomp, we get angry, we get agitated, we get mad because I can't do what I normally do. I can't do it the way I normally do it. I can't do it in the normal time frame I'm doing it because something has caused me to be disrupted. You know how you get when you sit in traffic? You get angry, you know, you get agitated because I can't get through fast enough. Well, folks, I'm just saying this because what we're going to have to experience, we're going to have to experience disruptions, and we're going to have to experience things that are, it's not going to be a pleasant. Back to the age group. Under 60, they're saying you've got a real good chance of just, if you contract it, of getting through it pretty easy. 60 and over, even with minor health issues, they're saying you need to be restrictive on your travel and where you go and doing things. If you've got anything at all that's going on medically. If you're over 65 and do have some type of chronic illness, some type of medical issue, they're saying you need to really restrict not only your travel, but you need to restrict going to where larger crowds are. 70 and over, they're saying you're in a high risk area. You're in the red up here. You're in the high risk.
I said, in other words,
well, I wouldn't get into bed. But that's the high level risk age group, because that's the one. And the reason we know that is that's the ages that people have already been dying. And that's what they have to go by. The only statistics they got, folks, is what they've got, is the people that's got it, and they're going by that. It's new. This is new ground, new territory, and all the world, the WHO, they call it, the World Health Organization, WHO, they're admitting, we just don't know. We can tell you how to deal with a normal virus, such as the flu, but when you get into specifics with this one, the big thing, it's a respiratory attack. And it's attacking lungs. And what it does, it gets in your lungs and it causes something called fibrosis. And it comes on rapidly. Sheila, I'm sure, knows what I'm talking about. But it comes on rapidly, and that's where your shortness of breath takes place. And you have to get medical attention. You have to when that starts coming on. We as a group, and we as individuals, and we as families have to make decisions, and they're going to be tough decisions to make. What I'm suggesting is everybody be prepared. If you haven't started preparing, you need to start preparing, as in tomorrow morning, first thing, that soon, you need to be preparing. How do you get prepared? You get prepared by preparing a supply of food for you and your family. You prepare by having enough water, enough food. You have the supplies such as batteries and flashlight and different things, because honestly, we don't know how far and we don't know how long this is going to last. I've heard anywhere from weeks to months. Okay, so you need a provisions. For I would, just going by what suggestion, it was 7 to 10 days. Now I think it's extended to 30 days. And if you got more than one family member in your house, that's per individual now. You're talking about food, water, and supplies for each individual in the household that you need to prepare for. Something else you need to prepare, we call it a go bag. Y'all familiar with that term? It's called a go bag. You take a duffel bag, a suitcase. If you don't have that, I'd take me about 3 or 4 Walmart bags that you got left over, or Kroger bags. You could take brown paper bags, and I would put some supplies in those things. I'd put some water. I'd put food. I'd put flashlight batteries. I'd put a string or small rope, matches, a lighter, things like that. You put that in that bag, and the reason you call it a go bag, in case you have to leave your home immediately, in case there's something, some circumstance. It could be weather-related. It could be earthquake. It could be man-made or natural disaster, or it could be something dealing with this virus, where if you have to leave your house, you can grab your go bag and go. And you've got enough you can take with you someplace, and you've got food and water and supplies that you'll need, a small first aid kit. I can get a list if anybody wants it of what you can put in one of the bags and also what you would need to start storing up. Listen, my prayer is that what I'm telling you, we don't have to do any of it. That's my prayer. I pray that I'm wrong on this. But what if I'm right? Are we prepared and are we ready? If you gather up food, canned foods and different things, what's the worst case scenario is you eat on it after all this is over with. You drink the bottled water and you go on. That's worst case scenario. But at least you're prepared and you're ready. Or you eat it and stock back up, because there's going to come another disaster or catastrophe sometime down the road. That's going to happen. Let's talk about church. It's my responsibility as the head of the house to make sure that we're as prepared as I'm the high priest of the home, as the Word of God tells me, and I got to make sure. And even though the responsibility falls on me, it's still what Robin and I decide to do. We do this as a team. We do this as husband and wife, and we make sure we're making the right decisions for a family. But ultimately, the responsibility falls to me. As one of the leaders of this church, the responsibility falls to me to make sure that I get the information to you so you can be best prepared for what's going to take place. So we're going to have to make some decisions how we're going to do things and how and if we start gathering. Michael Combs has been canceled, okay? So we're not having, he won't be here Friday night. We'll start advertising that on Facebook and getting the information. It's starting to get out, but we'll make sure that happens. Is everybody in here on the call, our call tree or our call line, to receive information? Yours not. Yours wasn't on it before, or was? If you want, okay, we need to get that off of there. And if you want to be on it, we need to add you on here, okay, to make sure. Brother Winston, Sister Jerry, and I had a meeting this morning. We've talked about all this. We've talked about what to do and how to implement things. And I told her, I told them, and they relayed to me, we want to do ever how the Lord leads us to do. I told her, I said, through this day I've been praying and I've been listening and I've been trying to discern on what he wants done. And at this point, I know we've canceled Michael, but I'm still, Sister Jerry, I haven't got a clear answer about Sunday. I just don't know. They're saying right now that the critical time will be from now, where we're at right now, next few weeks. Now, again, the governor suggested, he didn't say it's mandatory, said we can do what we want to do, but he said, I'm giving you information that I've received from the government and through CDC that we're suggesting churches maybe consider something different. Now, we do have live stream capability. I've talked to Jared about it already. If need be, I can live stream from my home. We've got a room designated as an office, and I can sit in the office, and we can live stream and have church through live stream. Okay? we've got that capability. So just the only thing we wouldn't be doing was just be sitting gathered here just like we are right now. Wherever you're at and you've got a phone, if you don't have that capability, or if you have some equipment, we will try to work and get everybody something or where they can get to access. We'll do our best if we can to try to arrange something if you don't have access to. And what you need is, what is it, Jared? Is it Facebook? Facebook? Okay. Because it's run through the House of Prayer Facebook. And then after that, it's posted up on the YouTube to view. You could view it at a later time. Our messages are up there for a period of time, or each service is. But we can live stream it. So it's thinking differently. It's doing things differently, but still being able to be in a service. You know, just like it's really kind of along the same lines of principle when we call off service because the roads are slick. We've got snow going on, and we cancel service. So that's what we're looking at maybe doing. That's a possibility. Right now, I don't have. Do you have any clear guidance? This at this point, I don't either. We're in areas we're just not used to being in, but that's all right. We know who we can trust. We know who won't let us down, and we know who our faith is in. So if everybody is on our call line, that means we can reach everybody here. Now, the unfortunate thing is this is usually the Wednesday crowd here. It's and a lot here. There's a lot not here. That's called the Sunday crowd, and it's more specifically the Sunday morning crowd. If it came down to it, you know, I'd come here and sit in the parking lot on Sunday morning and just tell people this is how we're having church, you know, and the time as it's being done. So I would try to think of everything and try to cover every base to make sure people are able to hear the gospel, hear us preach it or teach it. I think, Carl, you've got access, don't you? You don't have the internet access. I was thinking you. But you, if. But I'm just thinking about who all could live stream. If you had a message, you could live stream, or Brian could live stream. We will work this out to where we can make things happen if we need to do this. That's what I'm telling you.
Start to die off there, or dwindle down, or I don't know the right term. So if this is like a three or four month event for us in the United States, and as more in the county comes positive, would we mail our tithes to Sister Jerry?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
That's a good question.
You know, because the one thing is, it's not forever.
No.
But it's like you said, it's a change, and that's what they saw, is their whole lives were disrupted for about 3 to 4 months.
Yep.
And so we know the church still has to operate.
Exactly.
So she would still,
you know. Along the lines of where they shut the colleges down, the governor did mention for all schools in the state of Kentucky to be ready to shut down for a minimum of 10 days. Mm-hmm. That's probably going to happen next week. Because we just got an email before I left the house. They're having a meeting tomorrow at Bath County after school.
We had a meeting today.
And they said within 72 hours, be ready. So if you have school-age children, grandchildren, they're going to need a place to go. And
I think that's the two reasons that they haven't shut the schools down, high school through grade school. Well, number one is it's not affecting them like it is the older ones, number one. Number two is when they're not in school, somebody's got to watch the young ones. And that's what the government's working on now, is trying to do some type of pay compensation for whoever's got to be off work to take care of their kids during a time when they're not in school, because a lot of places don't, a lot of people don't have like sick days or personal days, vacation days. A lot do, but there's still a lot that doesn't have that. And when they miss work, they don't get paid, you know. So they're trying to compensate for that, that in case the, that, well, it looks like it's going to happen. And we've talked about, too, Sister Jerry is maybe trying to do something with addition to our tithes and offerings, something electronic, like being able to do pay online, you know, give tithes and offerings online through something like that, you know, through debit, and you can. But the way you'd work it, you wouldn't have to do anything. It would be set up to where the only thing you would need, it would go straight to the bank, and you'd have the receipt showing what went in, and who gave. So. But that's where a lot of things are going. I mean, in the future, that's where things are going, is electronic giving, you know, text to give. That's big. You can use your iPhones, or you can use your phones and give and pay tithes and offerings and do things like that. That's just where things are going. So, but Rex,
here. Should we start helping some way, stocking up the old mother church with water and canned food and stuff like that?
Well, I think right now the important thing is you and your family having it on hand, right there at this point. As time goes, you know, it may end up, you know, who knows? We've talked about it before. We all might end up out here, you know, whether it's on the campground or.
They think they'll hit an artesian well here, is what they think.
Yeah.
That's what Brother Billy Lewis was telling us.
Yeah.
So he's wanted to do that for a pretty good while, get the, you know, how you check that water.
Uh-huh.
And because he knows how to do that. Of course, different ones, I think, do it.
Yeah.
But that would be for, you know, for the finding the water, which would.
Right.
Be really handy for a church.
Oh, absolutely. Have a water source like that.
Yeah.
That would just be. The hardest part with that would be guarding it, you know?
Yeah.
Yeah. We'll let them angels get around. And your buddy Adam
get them. Let them guard it, yeah.
Would we still have food bank for the community? Would we still do the pantry if we were in quarantine for, I don't know.
If you're in quarantine, you wouldn't, of course, because there wouldn't be nobody coming. But, you know, that's down, you know, I think that's down the road. I think for the next few weeks, it's just going to be what individuals and their families are going to do. That's the area we need to concentrate and limit the gathering. You know, they call it social distancing, is to limit that too. Because, you know, I think I said it in here a week or so ago, if one person comes in here and they're not feeling well, and they experience symptoms, and they end up going to the doctor or going to the hospital, and their test comes back positive, every one of us has to be quarantined for 14 days. Just one person. You know, just by somebody having some symptoms. Praise the Lord. Oh, yeah. But now we got to keep him from getting in contact with anything or anybody. Yeah.
Do not go to the hospital.
Right.
Because when you go to the hospital, you contaminate everything in the hospital.
and they have to shut down. You can't have that. He said, what you need to do is either call the CDC or call the hospital and tell them that you're short of breath, that you can't breathe, that you think you have it. They will have you drive up and tell them what car you're in, and then they will come out, test you, and if they test you and you're positive, they will send you straight home to quarantine yourself mm-hmm. with meds and everything else. So whatever you do, don't go to the hospital.
Well, St. Clair's already got it's in place. If you...
Those types of symptoms, I was there for something else, and she told me they did not have the kids. This was St. Clair family, mm-hmm. and to call first, more than likely, I'd have to, if I was just a little bit sick, public health might do it, mm-hmm. might do the test, but they don't have the test. Not all the doctors in Moorhead have the test right. to do it, but if you're really sick, they want you to go. Well, they don't want you to die,
yeah.
so they want you to go.
I don't know about that, Sheila.
Yeah. Right. Well, right. Right. What I'm saying is, if you've got symptoms and you show up at the hospital and you've got any cough, fever, any of those symptoms, you're not going in the hospital. They've got a place that they're going to quarantine you for a period of time. So, but if you're having chest pains and shortness of breath, you need to go to the hospital. Because that could be something totally different. But if they start checking and you get symptoms of the flu or this virus, they got a different route they're going to take you. So, but if you need to go to the hospital, you need to go to the hospital. Don't say that, you know, don't put it off, that type of thing.
No visitors.
They've done that to the nursing homes too. Yeah. Same thing. No, in the jail. So, and it is for everybody's safety. It's for everybody's welfare, well-being. You know, people are going to look at this like this is a bunch of bull. This, I can't believe all this hype and all this stuff. You can have that mindset, and that's okay. But it doesn't make it any less real what's going on. What's going on is real, folks. I'm just telling you. Yeah. Well, the National Guard's been called out in New York, and there's a 1 mile radius that they're not using the word quarantine. They're just being restrictive who comes and goes within this 1 mile area. People are still able to come and go, but they've got in the outskirts. The National Guard is being used to transport supplies. That's what they're telling us. Okay, just to give the extra personnel there. They're not holding people in or putting people at gunpoint. They're not doing that stuff. So they want to make sure people knew that they're there for assistance. And I think you're going to see that at a lot of different places in a lot of different states, especially where you've got an outbreak. An outbreak is where you've got a real concentrated number of positive that comes in, and then at that particular time they're going to have to restrict things. By us or whoever, by restricting our movement in our area, that's what we're trying to do. The only way that you can stop the spread of something that they don't know what it is, just like this, is people have to quit traveling and going. Stay home, stay in an area, because the more you travel, the best, or the more you get out and go, the better the chances are you getting it, and you bringing it back. And here's the other key to it, and this is something I just heard just before I come to church tonight. They asked the I can't remember if it was the state doctor or the CDC. They said, number one, can somebody have the virus, be positive for the virus, and be walking around not knowing they've got it for a period of time? And they said, yes. They said, well, how long could somebody be walking around not knowing that they've got this? They said probably as little as 5 days, but up to 13 days. That you could be infected and infecting other people for 5 to 13 days. You don't have any symptoms or signs, but you're carrying it around infecting other people. They said that's why it makes it so dangerous, because people have it and don't realize they've got it, and they're not showing any symptoms. And they said that's one of the things with the younger ones, even with the school age kids, is it may not affect them physically, but what if they take it home to dad and mom and grandma and grandpa and aunt and uncle, and then 6-month-old baby brother or sister, if they bring it in. So they've said young children, but they haven't said anything about babies yet, because I think they just don't know at this point.
He's died, so, they
so there's no none's that's been reported. See,
if you're on a medicine that you have to have, like Polly, I don't know, but the doctors right now, Dr. Weigel's office has given 90 days supplies of important meds, you know, so think about that if you're not prepared.
This, if nothing else, has been a wake-up call for America, for our government. I hope it's been a wake-up call for the church to see how quickly and how rapidly things, life can change. And exactly. Exactly. And I think it will be. I think we're going to see a lot of people that don't know the Lord come to the ones that do and say, hey, what in the world is going on? What's happening? And this will be a great time to explain to them and witness and tell them about the Lord. But yes, that's absolutely right. But this is uncharted ground. There's a lot of unknowns right now. I just want to give this information out to you all to make sure that you're as informed as you can be and what you can do to help secure yourself and protect yourself, you and your family, because we all got a responsibility to that, to our families. And I know I take darts. I take them all the time. That's why I've got the shield of faith. But sometimes my old shield gets heavy, and because of the number of darts it goes out at me, but I can take the criticism. The one thing that concerns me is people that for the lack of terminology, they think they live in a spiritual bubble, and the Lord's not going to let nothing happen to me. That's the devil's tricking you if you believe that way. I'm just telling you. That's my advice.
I did a lot of research and stuff, and I kind of went too deep because I thought I was indestructible. Mm-hmm. And it kind of leads you to a dark place.
Yeah.
And stuff, and it really will put the fear in you, you know. And sometimes we have to fight to bring your
faith
back.
And
so, you know, people who want to research this and stuff, limit yourself. You know, because sometimes there's some things you can't unsee. And it goes on in the world, and, you know, it's been a struggle for me.
So. Right. Well, this is nothing that people should be afraid. You know, I talked about fear before. We have nothing to be afraid of. And matter of fact, this, if nothing else, this should increase our faith. We should be more spiritually uplifted to know that we do have the Lord with us, that He goes through things with us. Like I said earlier, we live in a world where there is sickness, disease, and conflicts, and turmoil, and all this stuff, and we go through this. If there's somebody in here that's never been sick and never went to the doctor, you know, God bless you. I'm not there. I'm just not there, you know. And as we continue, we're going to continue to do that because we live in a real world, and we're going to deal with real things. I believe in the spiritual side. I believe in the faith. And we got to have that, but also you got to be real with it. This is where we are. True.
Yeah. Not saved.
That's right.
So I mean, Job, they're getting out there through the world.
Yep.
Did they say anything? State to state travel. I know our daughter was.
Go ahead.
Have they talked about state to state travel? Our daughter works in Cincinnati, and they've been telling her that when she gets in, they're going to be to a point maybe where they limit
yep.
coming back into the state.
Yep.
They're absolutely saying restrict your travel. At this point, they're not saying do not travel, but they're saying restrict it. And definitely, they did say this, don't be on any planes, boats, trains, closed-in areas, you know. So, I mean, they're saying restrict that type of travel for sure. But, you know, as far as going into other states and places, they're saying just you need to restrict it. And if it's not a necessary thing, they're saying at this point, I wouldn't go. What was you saying, Bill?
I was saying education is a powerful tool.
It is.
And that's how you can fix them like that.
Absolutely.
Prayer. He said he'd have us not be here.
That's right. Well, thing about they got to understand is I can take it. That's what they got to understand. You know, I'm beyond that. You know, people can ridicule me all they want to. That's part of the position, okay? Is he? Do you have something, Linda? Oh, I saw a hand. You scratching your head. It's kind of like at auctions. Sold. I just scratching my head. That's the key right here. That's the key. If we've prepared all we can prepare, if we've done what he tells us to do in that and keep our faith up, and when we get to that point and we need more, he's right there. That's when he steps in. That's where he likes to work. But if we sit back and we cross our arms and we say, Lord, take care of that. I ain't worried about that. I'll go just do this. Well, you can. You've got the freedom of choice. You go do those things, and you continue to do those things. And I pray that you don't experience the hard time and what goes along with that. But what I wouldn't do, if you're not doing your part, I wouldn't say, Lord, I've got into this mess. I need your help. I mean, I wouldn't do it because you didn't trust him as you were preparing. Why would you start now? You know, but that's fine. You know, that people will, and Sister Jerry and I talked about this today. People, we're going to do what we want to do. People do what they want to do. I'm just making sure you've got all the information I have, because shame on me if I don't tell it. If I don't get this information and not share it with you, shame on me, and I'll stand in judgment for that. But I'm not going to do that. I don't want nobody pointing a finger at me and saying, you never told me. You never warned me. And you said in some of your messages, you as a watchman, and you're supposed to be watching out. Well, that's exactly what I'm doing. I'm a watchman. I'm sounding the alarm. I'm telling you what's going on. And you make the proper preparations yourself. The only thing that we're going to have to come up with is if and when we decide we're going to do this other than us gathering around. But be assured, we'll have church service. We'll have service. We may not have, for a short period of time, might not be able to gather all together, but we'll have church. And if anybody at all, we'll do our best, try to make it to where you'll be able to hear it and be able to see it. Now, it may not be, if it can't be done from your living room or from your kitchen table, we might have to make some other arrangements, but we'll do our best to make those arrangements if you want to hear the church service. Okay? I thought it'd take longer to do that. And I think I've covered everything that I didn't rehearse it today, but I was trying to gather in as much information as I could from different sources. And as I told you earlier, I had to decipher it from all this over here and all this over here to bring something in the middle to where I think that this is really the truth of the way it is. But the main thing that I want you to know at this point is after all this deciphering and discerning, what I've been able to come up with that's kind of the most shocking is, honestly, they really don't know. This is unknown territory. Nobody knows. They're speculating. They're going by some data that they've got from people that's already got it. They're giving us information on people that have already died or already contracted it. Now, you think about this. If, and pray, you know what we can do? We can say, Lord, you stop this as quick as it started. Just almost immediately. I mean, it started a few months ago, but he can stop it. And that should be our prayer. But if you before I say this if, let me tell you this. In Matthew 24, he did say there'll be famines and pestilence. There's going to be these things come up on the earth, which he said is the beginning of sorrows, okay? These things are coming. This is not the only thing. This is not the only one that's out there, okay? But if what they're saying is true, and if this is not stopped, you think about this. Lowest number I've heard is 480,000, up to millions in the United States dying. You think what this country would be turned into. You know, we're a country of, what, 350 million? I mean, one life out of the 350 million is too much. But you think of 480,000 to millions. If nothing's not done, if there's not restriction, if we all are not doing our part, doing nothing really is not an option, because things like that will happen. It's up to us to do our part. And we pray. We study. And we say, Lord, we trust you. Everything around us is rough. But, Lord, we trust you. I told Sister Jerry today, and sis, I do believe this. If we've done all we can do and we need food, there's no doubt in my mind right now we could walk out and there'd be manna laying on the ground. If we needed food, I guarantee you there would be manna laying and we could go pick it up and we would be sustained physically, just because he did it for his people at one time, and I guarantee he'd do it for us.
You needed food, you prayed for it, didn't you? Extended
food. I said,
Lord,
you stretch that food, because, I mean, when you cook for, I mean, I know I always cook extra, but I didn't, not that extra, like cook for, really, I hadn't cooked for seven, and they was 27, yeah. Mm-hmm. And Winston was sitting at our table, and he watched them, and they'd take a big spoonful out, and he'd just like it come right back. And he said he'd eat them leftovers until he was sick of them.
He said he ate all week on leftovers. He said that there's still some left.
Yeah, there was. I mean, I said, Lord, you sure done your thing.
Fishes in the loaves.
We come in here every Sunday and Wednesday, and preach the word, and it's just like, to me, this other thing has come up, it's just like it's coming to church.
Yeah.
We're getting prepared to go home.
Yeah.
When we come to church. Mm-hmm. And just like you're telling us that, you're giving us the information for us to get prepared to go through this.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's just the way I believe it.
Yeah.
You know, in 1908, the flu hit the United States.
Yeah.
They didn't know what it was. They didn't know anything about it. Thousands upon thousands died.
Yeah.
I mean,
called the plague, didn't they? Or something to start with.
Huh?
Did they call it a plague or something like that to start with? They didn't know.
Well,
what
it started to, and it come up with a flu. But I mean, it's just, you know, it's not the first time. There's a government that nobody knows where it was then either. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Nobody got ready.
Rex, I think you hit on something key, is like you said, and this is part of what I said earlier about us being spoiled. We believe every Sunday and every Wednesday we're going to show up here and we're going to do things like we always did, do it the same basic way. You know, we'll have an order of service and we'll do – what I'm saying is we got in such that we believe tomorrow's going to be here. And I understand we've got to think that. We've got to, because we got a plan. But there's no guarantees, are there? There's no guarantee of what's going to happen tomorrow. We can talk about tomorrow, but we don't really know what's going to take place tomorrow or Friday or Saturday or Sunday. But one thing we can do is we can prepare to be where we need to be tomorrow, Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. We can believe that we're going to be here when it's church time, because when church time and church doors are open, that's what we do. We come to church. That's just it, but we got to understand things can get disrupted, things can get changed, and things can get moved around.
say this because I don't do this very often, but you know, I was thinking today and sitting here thinking now, walking through stuff, you know, Jesus, when he knew, when he went into the other city, and he knew they was after him, what did he do? He didn't go straight through it. He went in and around them and out.
Yeah.
He avoided it.
Yeah.
So in a way, this is avoiding it.
Yes. It is. It is. And Jesus knew what to do. And if there's information for us to know what to do, we better do it. That's right. If he didn't.
Are we more than Jesus?
And he had to slip through a crowd because they were after him. He had to walk, like you said,
that's
in a different
exactly
direction
right
to keep from being captured and
somebody grabbing him because it wasn't his time. And I don't want it to be my time. I don't know about you all. Is there anybody here tonight that's not saved that would, you know, say that I'm not saved or I'm not where I need to be with the Lord? Because I'm going to make sure tonight that if there's anybody that is any doubt whatsoever that you need to pray, I'd love to pray with you tonight. Number one, to receive Jesus. Number two, to be restored and rededicated and back serving him with a whole heart. So I don't see anybody. And, you know, Wednesday nights, I, like I said, I call this family. You know, this family, this is the close bunch. And it just worked out. This is the night that we got the family together. And that's a good thing. Like I said, everybody, make sure, Robin, get your number. Okay, you got it? Okay. And we'll get you that other one off and get this one added. But between now and Saturday, I'm just trying to get a direction, okay? I don't want to rush into anything. I don't want to rush one. I don't want to step out of line whatsoever. I just want to get a direction. And I want, you know, I'm going to ask the Lord to just give me guidance, give me wisdom, and we'll talk it over and we'll just, you know, we'll do what we believe is best. Now, I'll say this. I'm going to do what I think is best. I know Brother Wayne and Sister Jerry, but I'm going to speak for myself. I'm going to do what I think is best for our body here. Okay? Now, if anybody wants to, I'll step aside and I'll give it to anybody that wants it. That wants this position and wants this mic. If you want to come and get it, I'll do it. But otherwise, I've got to do what I think is what the Lord is telling us to do. And that's my prayer that he's answering the prayer I've been praying because I told him I need a shepherd's heart. I need something to, you know, because I've had to deal with that. I haven't always had a shepherd's heart. I tend to get a little hardcore sometimes, but I need compassion. And I believe a lot of you do pray for him. And when you do pray for him, you say, Lord, you bless him with a shepherd's heart of compassion. And I know it's happened through my career in law enforcement because I've had to deal with a lot of issues and people just looking at you, smiling, just lying to you, and just saying the awfulest things ever was, and you just deal with it, and you take it, and you take it, and over time it just builds up, and just I think it's not hard. I just get crusty. I got a little crusty, and I just need that crustiness softened, and I think a lot of it is the Lord's doing that. But I'm a work in progress. I'm telling you, he's still working on me. He really is. And I want what's best for us all. Okay? All right.
Have a house. Full of girls.
You would? Yeah. Yeah.
Well, sis, what I would do is I would prepare for it because I think it's coming. I think it's coming. So prepare for it. Yeah. And this is what I couldn't understand earlier in the week. I went to the grocery store, and I was looking for the wipes and the disinfectant. Well, it was an empty shelf. I took a picture and sent it to Robin. I said, look here, bare shelf. Yes, but here's what surprised me. There was a run on toilet paper. There was a whole section where they had 10 or 12 stacks of toilet paper. It was gone. And two or three of us standing there looking at it going, where'd all that go? I can see getting disinfectant wipes, but Why would you make a run on that right now?
House of Sam's Club Saturday.
Same thing?
It was totally empty back there except for about a dozen or so packages of toilet paper and paper towels and maybe about that much Kleenex on the pack. Rest of them shelves
gone.
Totally empty. Gone. Yep.
So.
And Joe, I was at Lowe's today. There were like, it looked like five businessmen in suits and ties. They had like 80 those things of Santa wipes.
Yeah.
And just fill them in a trunk clump full of it.
See, I heard Carl earlier. Carl
just wants to get rid of the leaves. He wants somebody to get there, get rid of them leaves. So. Say it again.
Certain things we're dealing with in our company, they're dealing with certain things to clean with once a week. And I said, have we talked about if we do have services, we may need to disinfect
here, yeah.
So forth.
Robin and I have talked, and I know we've mentioned Sister Jerry about putting some the wipes and the hand sanitizer, put some up here, put some in the back and in the foyer, and just. Yeah.
This is to last forever. You combat the flu by doing that, you combat all kinds of viruses, just staying hygienically
clean. Yeah, just clean, washing your hands, wiping down. Yeah, that's a good point. Just having things available. To
well, we were dealing with a certain type of chemicals that we're already using, but we were trying to find out from CDC and as a company wide what we need to be using and what we don't need to be using.
Yeah.
Because if we've got some of these soap containers that we add water to that just and it dilutes the soap down so much that it's not actually doing anything.
Right.
And
here's something else too. If need be, you can make your own sanitizer. Okay.
70, I just saw it last night. 70%
aloe vera gel,
and then the aloe vera
gel,
and just add that in there and get the thickness you like, and then
you
get
do
it
that.
In your little
or bleach and water.
Bleach
yep.
and water.
That's if you find that on the shelf.
And they said it's out of bleach on the
yeah, a lot of places are out of bleach too.
But you know, you can make your own. That's what we're saying, and can you can do that also.
Yes.
Anything you touch.
Your doorknobs.
Doorknobs.
Yes.
Yeah.
Your
everything.
Refrigerator handle.
Yes.
Your ice maker Dewey thing.
And I'll give you something to think about too. This is something. Your money.
You're putting your debit card in that keypad. That keypad's been touched by everything.
Yeah.
So what I suggest is you keep some type of sanitizer with you. In your vehicle or wherever, and then you wipe your card down. Just put some on your hands. You don't have to dip it in it, but just wipe it on there with that. And I have not a answer to how you would disinfect your money, your cash money, like bills, even coins. This virus, they said that a normal virus will... If it's, let's say this has been touched and this has got a virus on it, after a period of time, it will die off after a period of time. It's, but on this one, on the corona, they don't know. Yeah. So.
Is at a bank today and they was wearing gloves counting the money.
Yeah,
we got an email from people not counting the money.
Really?
Yeah. So use the drive.
Yeah.
One last thing, and then I want us to pray a certain way tonight, since everybody I believe is saved and nobody needs to be rededicated. One last thing I want to say, You know, we talked, and there's people talking and discussing in different places. Some churches right now, they're doing the elbow touch. They're doing the fist bump. They're doing a shoulder. They're doing a toe touch or whatever. But, and that's all well and good, but if you're that close to do it, don't you're still too close. Because this is airborne, folks. This is in the air. If we're all in this close proximity where we are right now, and we're all breathing the same air, if anybody has this type of virus, it's airborne, so we're all breathing the same air. So we're too close right now at this distance. So it don't matter whether you shake hands or at this point. If we're this close, it's the same air. So if one's got it, guess what? That's just the way, and that's how contagious it is, because it's airborne. It is.
Quarantine.
CDC website, so it's not just a hearsay, just to kind of get an idea to compare, because I like to compare things. The numbers kind of speak. So this was from the CDC, and 2018 to 19, just on the flu, it said up to 42.9 million people got sick during 2018 to 2019 in the flu season. 647,000 people were hospitalized, and 61,200 died. And that's just the flu. Mm-hmm. So when you think of that, it kind of, to me, it kind of made me feel a little better. Mm-hmm. Not that, you know, this, any of it's good.
Right.
But, you know, this is bad. Flu's bad too.
True. Mm-hmm.
And, but precaution is always the best way to go.
Exactly.
And Joe, did you see anywhere researching today, the reason everything's moving so fast is we have the ability to test for it. Mm-hmm. We've not been tested for it 6 months ago,
right.
3 months ago, 3 weeks ago even. So they keep coming positive, positive, positive. Perhaps it's been in the flu season already. Perhaps people who've gotten really bad flus and pneumonias already been exposed. Mm-hmm. Perhaps we're all positive and don't know it.
Yeah.
I mean, we've just not been tested.
Right.
So that, don't get scared when you see every day those numbers go up, because every day now they're testing people when before we weren't.
Well, and initially we were having trouble getting information from China. China was not releasing any information, and we don't know, because China media is government run, and the government's going to let you know what they want to let you know in China. So understand that too. So, but yeah. I feel led to pray this way. I feel like we all just, where we're at, just stand.
Yes.
Yes, Joe.
Teams, show, mm-hmm. radio, whatever here. You've done good.
I've done very good.
Well, I appreciate it. Praise the Lord that, you know, he's given us wisdom. And I'll continue to do this. And if I get any updates that I think the body needs to know, we'll do it by phone tree and through Saturday, okay? By Saturday, we'll place a call out, and we'll let everybody know by Sunday, okay? And I'm you pray that the Lord give us direction and guidance, okay? Myself and Robin and Sister Jerry and Brother Winston, we'll know by Saturday what direction we need to go on that, okay? But you. Amen. Amen. But I feel led to pray like this tonight. Right where we're at, let's do an agreement prayer, first and foremost, that this virus stops dead. It dies out immediately, and we thank the Lord for it, and then I'll lead the prayer, and then we pray a protection over all of us, and that the Lord give us all wisdom and knowledge on how to be prepared for this or whatever comes along. That's how I feel led to pray tonight, okay? So I'll lead it, and let's pray it. Everybody pray with me. And then I'll pray a blessing over before we leave.
Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, for what you're doing for us, Lord. We thank you that you're there, and Lord, that you speak to us, and you give us the knowledge, the wisdom, the understanding that we need for such a time as this, and the things that we're experiencing and things we're going to go through. You said you would not let things overtake us, and we can be overcomers because, Lord Jesus, you overcame, and therefore we can become overcomers. And Lord, we pray for knowledge. We pray, Lord, that you'll just give us the ability and give us the finances, give us everything that we have need, Lord, to be prepared, us and our family. And that we know, Lord, that we've got faith to believe that you will be there for us. We'll do our part, Lord, and we know that you'll do yours because you're faithful and you will do what you said you would do. Father, I ask you to watch over us, bless us, keep us safe, give us traveling mercies, Lord. And Lord, just whatever it is, we may not know what we have need of at this point, but whatever it is that we do have need, you give it unto us, Lord. And we claim this, Father, by faith. We speak it out from our kingdom authority, and we claim victory in this, Father. And Lord, we're just going to say, and we'll speak it, and we're going to say, Lord, you let this virus die right where it's at. You just let it stop. Don't let any more lives. And Father, we'll thank you and we'll believe, Father, that all things will be done accordingly. And Father, we thank you for everything. May the Lord bless you. May the Lord keep you. May his face shine upon you. May he be gracious unto you. May he lift up his countenance upon you and may give you peace. In the name that's above every name, the name of Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus the Christ, our Lord and Savior, we pray. And everybody said, amen. Everybody be blessed, and we'll be communicating with you.